Ladies and gentlemen, on my way up here, I brought you this piece of preserved human skin. It's the lower arm of a Boston whaler found 150 years ago on the streets of Boston. In those days, there was no photography, so they didn't know how to preserve the image of somebody. So like they would keep the tattoo above the ground for later identification. It broke. Formaldehyde all over me. But let's start where I wanted to start. In the French city of Beaulieu, one can see the world's finest pieces of needlework ever, the Beaulieu Tapestry. And it's a medieval iconography report of the Battle of Hastings in 1066, where William the Conqueror defeated Harold II. And when the battle was over, Edith the Swan Neck, his wife, went up on the battlefield and went through all the demolished bodies to look for her husband. And she identified her husband by two tattoos. He had his love for England on the left side and his love for his wife on the right side. And tattoos has always been a way to identify people. In 1978, the Herald of Free Enterprise sunk in front of the Zeebrugge harbor, and 80% of the whole identification was done by the tattoos. Up till today, this is a way to identify people. Next to the teeth, tattooing is a very easy way. I'm pretty sure that the Malaysian Air disaster, also people were identified by the tattoos. Tattoo has a big role in this matter after death. There is not only the identification, Dutch sailors get tattooed, they have golden earrings to make sure that they can pay for their good Christian funeral, and the tattoo which identifies them also as a Christian, which is of course important. The military, the divers, the sailors all had these tattoos to make sure that they were identified as the right person. The role of tattooing after death is also an important one. We used to guarantee tattoos in the tattoo shop until 14 days after rigor mortis kicked in. And there is a lot of different cultures where the tattooing actually has a very important role after that. With the Kenyan people, for example, the tattoo should be very black because they give light in the hereafter, the light which helps you in the darkness of the hereafter. Also, these tattoos were like stamps in a passport. These were decorations picked up during life, and these decorations you had to show by different ghosts who would check you on these tattoos, and it would bring you finally to the spot where you could swim in a nice, beautiful lake with a bunch of with presents on the floor of the lake, and you could dive for these presents. And if you were untattooed, you had to watch and see all these other people play in the lake and dive for the presents. The Naga people of northern India near the Burmese border have tattoos where the ladies have tattoos of marriage. And so when they die, the god sees that the lady is married and she can wait for her husband. Otherwise, she will be given away to one of the warriors in the hereafter. In Biak, there is tattoos which have to attract the worms to eat you. So there's a little tattoo which pleases the worms and makes you the worms come and eat your body. The Ainu people in Japan, in Hokkaido, have tattoos which, again, are marriage tattoos and are only, if you don't have it, it will be done in heaven, and it's more painful in heaven when they do this. Tattoo has always been a very important thing after that, but also as a mourning aspect. When King Kamehameha died in Hawaii, all the Hawaiians tattooed their tongue. The tongue is a very extremely painful part to tattoo, especially the point of the tongue, where it has a lot of touch senses. So they tattoo this thing, which is extremely painful. So they have something else. Like the, you will actually switch your mental pain for a physical pain. It's the same way when I came home as a little kid and tell my father, this guy hit me, and I was crying. He would hit me and say, here's something to cry about. And because he was a Marine and he was a butcher. And so, like, this is exactly what primitive people do. They look for it. And in my shop, the same thing happens all the time. I have, the second day after the Malaysia crash, I had already people who came in for a portrait of their father or a small tattoo to remember their. It is a very fashionable way to mourn at this moment. If it takes a little longer after that, after they cremated people, they bring in the ashes of the deceased and put a little bit of the ash in the ink and tattoo. And this is not only for people. People bring the ash of a whole horse, a fucking a jar this this full, and I gotta go with a spoon in there and do the ash of the horse in the tattoo, or the dog of the cat. Different strokes for different folks. But I also had one of the first kids who blew up in Afghanistan, Timo Smeing, I think was his name. And 11 of his friends visited me in the tattoo shop, and they all wanted a little dot on their heart to remember their friends. So they make a little bit of a bond. Tattoos collecting. I just wrote a little book. It's there. It's soaked in formaldehyde after this thing broke. So I cannot do anything. This is all about my tattoos, because as a person, as a tattooed person, before I became a tattooed person, I was a collector of stuff connected with tattooing. And I was at a German convention where this gentleman was, Karl Urgel, and I felt completely idiotic, like completely naked within this situation. So I thought of like a spy in the house of love, I got to get a tattoo. So I decided to be tattooed, and it took me weeks to figure out what the hell I was going to get and why. And I couldn't find the why, and I couldn't find. So I finally found a ram's head out of my father's biology book, which I happen to be a ram of but I don't believe in astrology. But anyway, I got the ram, and so it was my first tattoo. Then I quickly found out that there is no reason to really get tattooed in this society. So I took another one and a third one and a fourth one, and I became the center of my own collection. I started to collect tattoos which had to do with the history of tattooing, with a weird situation, getting a tattoo done in Samoa, which was done by hand with boar tusk on a stick, but which was against arthritis, and which is one of the oldest arthritis anti-arthritis medicines in the world, and there was only 5 people who had the damn thing. So I thought, I gotta have this thing too. So like I had my hand tattooed. But when I recently sat down and start to write down the history of every tattoo I have on my body, I have about 115, and all small ones and big ones, I figured out, I tried to find out what am I gonna do with this stuff. I have my collection. This is an enormous collection. I can leave it to a museum, or I can leave it to an archive, or even to a couple of museums, or I can make my own museum. But the center of my collection, that's me. I mean, even if the taxman steals all or takes all my stuff, I still have all my own artwork on me. And I figured out I gotta find a way to leave some of these pieces here while I'm gone. I like to leave the hand here, maybe on formaldehyde, like this. It was kind of weird to do this, talk this over with my children. What shall I leave? What shall I leave? And when I sort of tried to look into this stuff, I found out that there's more people who are doing the same thing. There is not a study group or there's not in the world who does not have pieces of human in their collection. Criminology, sociology, anthropology, everywhere there is human remains in their collection. If the Pope dies, they chop off a couple of his toes and they take his blood and they use the Pope. There is 18 churches in this world who have a piece of the foreskin of Jesus Christ. That damn thing must have been such an enormous. There is collections in the world. In London, you have the Wellcome Collection, which is a wonderful collection of 360 or 70 pieces of dried skin of early British tattooing. You have in France the La Cassagne Collection, which is a collection of tattoos out of the Africa Corps. Fantastic tattoos, all tattoos out of the days where tattoos were a little bit of a hidden and a situation. There's a lot of like semi-pornography there. Plaisir, Le Poutin, all kinds of ladies on sofas. It was known that Catherine the Great had 28 pornography tattoos on her body. Because in the old days, your underwear would start here somewhere and end here. So like now it's different. So like to hide all that pornography in a tanga, that doesn't work. Prince or so we have 3 minutes left. Okay. There is a lot of fantastic stories in the world of tattooing, especially of those people who used to collect all this stuff. I went into after a whole lot of bullshit and like letters, but the first time I went to like the Bishop, the British Museum, I was a very young boy and I tried to see Captain Cook's his papers and all his drawings, and I waited the whole afternoon, and then this British museum warden with a number on his head came and see me and said, "Excuse me, sir, but without the proper letters of recommendation, we cannot accommodate you." So I thought, fuck you. I'm going to, like, from now on, collect all these letters of recommendation. So I worked for a whole lot of museums worldwide, the Kai Bran Lee, the Natural History in New York, and I always asked a letter of recommendation. So by now, when I show up at some museum, they open the back door for me. The Americans disinfect you first with all kinds of, and then show you 20 coconuts which have been used in the Pacific. But like, I have a stack now like this, and I can go into museum. So in Japan, I actually saw somebody who tattooed me on the chest in 1987. And when he died, they made a wooden statue of him, and they put his skin on the wooden statue. So I was actually looking at a person who tattooed me, who sat on my belly, can I do that myself? Is it possible in Holland that they would stuff you? Like Saartje, some of you might remember the Hottentot girl who was stuffed. Saartje Berghardt, I think was her name. They finally brought her back to Hottentot land and buried her there. And now all of a sudden there is voluntary people who want to do this. When you go to the Damrak, you have the body show, and there is people been pulled apart in China. They bring them there with a boat. And so, tattooed skin, how do we keep it here? The last thing I found out, there is an insurance company who just opened up in the United States, and you can get your tattooed insurance, and when you're dead, they will give you the tattoo back framed, so the family has father's chest exactly the same as the chest as Tom Custer was killed by the Indians at the Battle of Little Bighorn, and the Indians cut the tattoo out of his chest and kept it for years on the teepee wall, I was going to say, but it doesn't have a wall, but it was kept. I have 6 more seconds. I guess that's it.